Thank you very much. Good morning, greetings, and namaste. I think those of you who practice yoga probably know the Sanskrit greeting of namaste. It's more than a greeting, it's also a prayer. And what namaste means is I honor the place in you in which the entire universe dwells. I honor the place in you that is of love, that is of truth, that is of beauty, and that is of peace. When you are in that place in you, and I am in that place in me, we are one. So my story, as was evident from the video, is a personal story. And I'm going to be addressing you today from that place in me where we are one. And I invite you also to listen to me from that place in you where we are also one. I've been an avid writer. I've authored 4 books. I keep an active journal. And I thought I might start my address to you this morning with the quote that I wrote in my journal soon after losing my son Tariq. There's nothing quite so painful as a broken heart. There's nothing quite so painful as a broken heart. But a broken heart is an open heart. If one can learn to live with an open heart, gentle transformations begin to happen. And part of my goal this morning is to open your hearts. I know being part of the PTA, you cannot be doing the work you are doing unless you have an open heart. So I want to first and foremostly acknowledge you for all the work you are doing for our children and youth. But there is no limit of how much your hearts can be open. As we have, I don't want to take a second here and acknowledge the victims of the tragedy in Charleston, which is not that far from where we are here today. And I was so touched when I heard the response of the families of the victims that actually had a lot of tears, because the response of grace, of empathy, of compassion, of forgiveness was very touching. And I truly believe that, and I think President Obama, I haven't heard his talk, but I understand he spoke at the funeral. And I truly believe that this particular tragedy will go a long way, it is my hope, in improving race relations, not only in our country, but in our world, because we really do need to address that. So I really want to also acknowledge all the families that have lost loved ones, and we pray to the Lord that he rests the souls of the ones that died in eternal peace, and also gives strength to the families to move forward in their absence. And it is an amazing example, and it gives me a lot of hope, and I hope it gives you a lot of hope. Now, needless to say that my heart was blown wide open. I don't know what is more complicated in life than to lose a child. And I went through all the emotions you would anticipate a parent to go through. Tariq was a student at San Diego State. He was a great kid, good writer, a good photographer, charismatic, had a beautiful girlfriend, and a joy to be around. And he was, you know, working as a pizza delivery man while he was going to school. And this was the last delivery when he was lured to a bogus address. And he knocked on many apartment doors to try and find out who'd ordered the pizzas. Of course, nobody had. He came to the car, put the pizzas in the trunk of his car. He climbed into the driver's side seat. As he was about to leave the scene of the crime, he was accosted by 4 youth gang members. And 3 of them were 14-year-old. The leader of the gang was an 18-year-old who gave a 9mm handgun to a 14-year-old. And as my son is trying to drive and back his car from the apartment's driveway, the 18-year-old gave the order, bust him bones, and he fired 1 round, which came through the driver's side window. It entered my son's body right here under the left shoulder blade, traveled above the you know, through the upper part of his chest, and the bullet actually exited from the right armpit. And as the coroner explained to me afterwards, he says the bullet followed a perfect path. A perfect path, I queried. I thought that was an interesting choice of words. It was very quick to tell me that, Mr. Khamisa, I'm not trying to be insensitive. We do not see a path like this very often. And what it means in our lingo is that it destroyed all the vital organs in your son's body, and Tariq died a couple of minutes later over a lousy pizza at the age of 20. The sudden, senseless death of an innocent, unarmed human being. The overwhelming grief of a family, the total confusion as you try to absorb a new hideous reality. And even though this tragedy happened 20 years ago, those early days are etched very deeply on my heart, on my mind, and my souls. And I remember one of the hardest things I ever had to do. I live in San Diego. Tariq's mother lived in Seattle, Washington. It's a long ways. One of the hardest things I ever had to do was to call Tariq's mother. How do you tell a mother that she's never, ever going to see her son again? How do you do that? Or hear him laugh or give him a hug? And it took me a while because Tariq had a very special relationship with his mom. I have a very special relationship with my mother. I'm certain many of you can relate. And I still remember that when I told her what had happened to Tariq, she let out this loud, piercing shriek as she hit the floor. And as I tell this story, which I often do even in our work of teaching nonviolence to kids, I can hear her shriek in my inner ear and will probably haunt me for the rest of my life. So why do I share this with kids? Why am I sharing this with you? Because it is painful. There's only one reason. Sometimes we do not know how painful violence is till it happens to us. At least I did not. But now I really, really get how painful violence is. And because I really, really get how painful violence is, I would never, never in my life be violent to another human being. And I think it's important not only that I get it, I think it's important we all get it, because there's way too much violence in our culture. I mean, Charleston, how many? We have 200 mass killings in the last 2.5 years. Way too much violence. I mean, Connecticut, Newtown, 5, 6, 7 years old, were gunned down in machine gun fire. Now, I really didn't do this work when my son was alive. I grew up in Kenya. I was educated in England. I worked as an international investment banker. I speak a half a dozen languages. And I actually left Kenya, escaping from the violence of Idi Amin in neighboring Uganda, thinking my children would be safe here. So it's very ironic that my son actually was killed in a street of a city and a country I'd picked for him. When I looked at the challenges of youth violence, there is no community in the United States that is not impacted by the challenge of youth violence. And I really took a different response to this tragedy. What I saw here is that there were victims at both ends of the gun. I saw my son was a victim of the 14-year-old gang member. I saw him as a victim of society, of American society. And that begs the question, well, who is American society? Well, it's you and me. I'm a first-generation naturalized American, but I am an American, and I love my country as I know all of you do. So as an American, I felt I must take my share of the responsibility for the bullet that took my son's life, because it was fired by an American child. Now, you could take the position, you killed my one and only son. I do have a beautiful daughter, thank God. He was not my only child. You could take the position, he killed my one and only son, he should be hung from the highest pole. How does that improve society? And I see that we looked at the response of the victims' families in Charleston. What they did will improve society. So with that mindset that I started the foundation, which is named after my son, called the Tariq Khamisa Foundation, and our mandate is to stop kids from killing kids by breaking the cycle of youth violence. And essentially, we have three mandates. First and foremost is to save lives of children, because we lose way too many on a daily basis. It's important to do that. Our second mandate is to empower the right choices so they don't end up in lives of gangs and guns and violence and drugs and alcohol. And our third mandate is to teach these principles of nonviolence, of empathy, of compassion, of forgiveness, of peacemaking. And I started with a very simple premise that violence is a learned behavior. No child was born violent. But if you accept that as a truism, then nonviolence can also be a learned behavior. But you have to teach it, because kids are not going to learn these principles through osmosis. And that's what we do at Tariq Khamisa Foundation. We've created what we call a safe school model. It has five components to it. The first is a live assembly, which you saw on the video, with me and the grandfather. I want to introduce this man's grandson, killed this man's son, and here they are together. And we're still together 20 years later, and we will continue to be together for the rest of our lives, because this work is as important to him as it is to me. We have in-classroom curriculum. We have after-school groups that deal with all the issues that, you know, that get kids involved with gangs. And we deal with drugs and weapons and alcohol and teen pregnancies and all of the stuff that we feel that we must address to make sure kids don't end up and fall through the crack. We have service learning projects, and we are very middle school focused. And we have mentoring, because what we have learned that between 8 and 12% of the kids are the challenging kids. And we hook them up with mentors. Each of our mentors can handle about 12 kids. And in 3 years, we've taken middle schools that are violent, that are gang infested, that have very high suspension and expulsions rate. And in 3 years, we get rid of the gangs, and we drop expulsions and suspensions by over 75%. It's amazing. And what gives me hope in having done this work for 20 years is that not only are these concepts teachable, our kids are hungry for them. So soon after I started the foundation, I asked the district attorney who handled my son's case to introduce me to Tony's grandfather. And at that first meeting, you know, I told him, I'm not here, you know, in the spirit of retribution or revenge. I'm rather here in the spirit of empathy and compassion and forgiveness, because what I see here is we both lost a son. My son died, and you lost your son to the adult criminal justice system. Tony was the first 14-year-old to be tried as an adult in the state of California. I can't bring my son back from the dead. And you cannot do anything to get Tony out of prison. It's not in your hands anymore. But I started this foundation with a mission of stopping kids from killing kids. The one thing you and I can do is to make sure no other young person in our community ends up dead like my son, or ends up in prison like Tony. That we can do. Will you help me? And he was very quick to take my hand of forgiveness. And I would never have met him had Tony not taken Tariq's life. We are very different. You know, he's African-American, although I was kidding about that. I was born in Kenya, so I was telling him, please, I'm the African-American in this group, not you. You were not born in Africa. I'm Muslim, he's Christian. And his grandson killed my son. I can tell you, he's as close to me as my own brother. And we've been together for 20 years. He's a great guy. I love being with him. He's one of the smartest guys I know. And we'll be together for the rest of our lives. And we teach this, that from conflict, it is possible to create unity. In Mandarin Chinese, the symbol for crisis, which essentially is a conflict of major proportion, has both a symbol of danger and opportunity. Because in a crisis, the danger is to create more conflict. The opportunity is to create a brother or a sister, to create love and unity. It depends on the choice that you make. Now, typically, what happens in a conflict is you create more conflict. But we teach the kids that in conflict, there is opportunity to create a brother, to create a sister, to create love and unity. And they see very life as an example of the relationship that I have with the grandfather. We teach that we can all make good and nonviolent choices. You cannot destroy dark with dark. You cannot destroy hate with hate. Only love can do that, to quote MLK. So we teach that we must respond even to violent action nonviolently. We can all make good and nonviolent choices. Bullying obviously is a huge problem. We teach the kids that are being bullied that you can always respond with empathy, because bullies were not born. Most bullies have issues going on in their homes and they need help. So you do not want to meet violence with violence, because you cannot destroy violence with violence. You have to respond with empathy. We teach that we can all choose forgiveness instead of revenge, because forgiveness will break that cycle. Revenge is the precursor of every new act of violence. You take one of mine, I take one of yours, pretty soon nobody is standing. So we teach the kids that forgiveness is something that is very important to put in your toolkit. I wish I could tell the kids that you're never ever going to have to deal with violence. Obviously, that is not practical. I mean, we work a lot in inner city schools. And I ask, how many of you have lost family members as a result of violence? And 2/3 of the hands go up. The first time I asked that, I couldn't believe it. You're talking middle school kids, 12, 13, 14 years old. So it's a lot of violence, but they can respond with forgiveness instead of revenge. That's the only way I know how we can break the cycle. And I think this is what we're going to see in Charleston. 5 years later, I figured that for me to complete my journey of forgiveness, I had to eventually come eyeballs to eyeballs with Tony, because he was the person who took my son's life. Now, that's hard to do. It's hard to do for us mortals. So it took me a good 5 years. I used to meditate an hour a day when Tariq was alive. My practice today is 2 hours a day. And it took thousands of hours to build the courage to eventually go visit with Tony. And I remember that meeting very clearly, because I told Ples, I said, I'd known the grandfather for a good 4 years. I said, I'd like you to go with me when I meet Tony, but I need some alone time with Tony, because he was the last person to see Tariq, and there were some holes in the story that only he could fill. And if you're there, he may not be as open. So I'd like you to be there, but then I'd like you to leave us alone for some time. And he left us alone for an hour and a half, and Tony and I talked man to man. And he was able to fill some of the stories. But at one point in that hour and a half, I remember I locked eyeballs with him. I'm looking in his eyes, and he's holding my glance for what seemed like a very long time. I'm looking in his eyes, trying to find a murderer, and I didn't. I was able to climb through his eyes and touch his humanity. I recognized that the spark in him was no different than the spark in me or you. And I wasn't expecting that. He was remorseful. He was well-mannered. He was well-spoken. And he did not portray any of the attitudes of a typical 19-year-old in our society. I wasn't expecting that. He's a likable kid. If he walked through those doors, you would have the same impression of him as I did. So at that point, I told Tony, not only have I forgiven you, I want you to know that when you come out of prison, you have a job waiting for you at the Tariq Khamisa Foundation, and you can come and join us. And the next day, the grandfather called me and he said, that meeting you had with Tony was very transformative for him. And I said, you know, Ples, it was for me as well. I don't know why I waited 5 years. because as I left the prison, there was a new bounce in my stride. I felt like a big weight had gone off, you know. Tony's not a bad kid. He made a bad choice. In my third book, there's a chapter called Realize with Realize. Sometimes there's way too judgment here that you've got to look at situations with the eyes of your spirit, with your soul. So the grandfather says, as you were leaving, Tony looks at me and says, Daddy, that's a special man. I've murdered his one and only son. Not only has he forgiven me, he's offered me a job. I'm not worthy of his forgiveness. I'm not worthy of his job offer. Now, prior to that, he would tell his grandfather, I'm not going to make it in prison. He's a young, good-looking, charismatic boy in an adult prison. And I don't have to tell you the challenges of that. But after I gave him some love and gave him some hope, he said, I'm going to work very hard at it. At 22, he aced his GED. He's 12 units away from his degree in child psychology. He wrote the foreword to my fourth book and did an amazing job. So my first was from Murder to Forgiveness, Forgiveness to Fulfillment, because the work I've done has been very, very fulfilling. Investment banking was about money. This is about saving lives of children. Far more important to do. So I always say, I am an investment banker who's now a social worker like most of you. And I look at that as a step up in my career. Because this is more important to do. You know, teachers and social workers should make more money than investment bankers. You know, that's the world we want to create, you know. So I can't wait to get Tony out. And my, you know, so it went from Murder to Forgiveness, Forgiveness to Fulfillment, Fulfillment to Peace. And that's the last book I wrote. Came out about 7 months ago. I asked Tony to write the foreword on it. And we also have excited news just got last month that he now has a parole date. But he's still October of 2018. And of course I'll be there. And maybe you'll pray that he will be released. And I know we've saved him. But think about the power of him on stage, his grandfather and me, when he looks at the students and says, when I was 11, I joined a gang. When I was 14, I murdered Mr. Khamisa's son. I spent the last umpteen years in prison. I'm here to tell you, it's not worth it. Do you think the kids will listen to that voice? Yeah. Because his intonations will be of a person who pulled the trigger. So it shows you the power of forgiveness. I've created a couple other programs. One is called Can I, which is constant and never-ending improvement. It's already in 9 cities. It's essentially targeting youth offenders, where the recidivism rate in our juvenile system is 80%. The recidivism rate is measured over the last 5 years in these 9 cities under 30%. I don't have a lot of time to go in there, but I'm going to be doing some Q&A at the demo stage, and then I've also got some books to sign, and if you want to come talk to me one-on-one, if you're interested in that program, it would be very useful. I'm also the president of the Child Safety Network, which has a long-standing relationship with the PTA, and it was started by a good friend of mine, Ward Lieber, and one of the reasons I took that position is because it's really a network, because what I've really learned in my journey going through the last 20 years, I speak all over the world. I've given 1,000 presentations to the school kids, just over 1 million. What I've learned is there are many good programs out there, and I'm sure there are many right there in the audience. And if you want to email me, it's president@csn.org, president@csn.org. Because what I'm really looking to do here is to create a national center for child safety and parenting. And PTA is a very good example of the collaboration, because I truly believe that no one organization, and I include mine, has a complete solution. No one organization has a complete solution. But collectively, I believe we do. But we must come together as a collaborative force. And nonprofits are not very effective in doing collaboration. In the business world, you call it mergers and acquisitions. It happens all the time. But in the nonprofit world, since there is no profit motivation, the motivation is social change, people have a tendency to be very close and holding on to their turf. The national safety, we don't care who gets the credit. We just want to make kids safe. And I think it's going to take that kind of a collaboration. So the National Center for Child Safety and Parenting is working. And if you have a program, please email me, and would love to have you included as part of our local as well as our national strategy, because we can learn from each other. And there are many programs other than the ones I've created that I've already invited to become part of this network. So again, president@csn.org, throw me an email, and I'd love to also meet you personally if you have time during the Q&A. So my time is almost over, and I wanted to finish by another quote that I wrote in my book after 9/11, and that quote was really the basis of my last book, From Fulfillment to Peace. Now, I know I go speak over the world, I know everybody knows exactly where they were on 9/11. It's heavy on our hearts, and it's a little heavier on my heart because I am a practicing Muslim, and the perpetrators of this atrocity were from my faith. So I went into this very deep introspection after that. It's not the faith, because the same faith helped me to get to forgiveness. And all faith teach that. I mean, I would say the biggest example of forgiveness is Lord Jesus Christ. I'm nailing him to the cross, what does he say? Forgive them, Father. They do not know what they are doing. We saw this again in Charleston. All faith teach that. But needless to say, I went into this very introspective space. I was there for almost 6 months, and what came out is this quote. Sustained goodwill creates friendship. Now, that ought to be obvious. You don't make friends by bombing them. You make friends by extending goodwill, right? So sustained goodwill creates friendship. Sustained friendship creates trust. Sustained trust creates empathy. Sustained empathy creates compassion. Sustained compassion creates peace. Does that make sense? It's called my peace formula. Starts with goodwill, goes to friendship, trust, empathy, compassion, and peace. When people ask me, how do you extend goodwill to the person who murdered your child? I tell them you do that through forgiveness. As it's evident, it worked for me. What is a miracle, it worked for the kid who killed my son and his family. It can work for you, and you, and you, and you, and your families. It can work for Israel and Palestine, North and South Korea, Syria, Iran, Afghanistan, Iraq. Of course, it can work for the United States of America. And indeed, it can work for the planet. So my sisters and brothers, let me leave you with this thought that peace is possible. How do I know that? Because I am at peace. Thank you very much, and have a wonderful conference. Thank you.